Well, now, though, we are going to get an update on our top story from the chair of the Coalition for Epidemic Preparedness, Jane Halton, as scientists are scrambling to gather information about that new strain of COVID-19 that has been declared a variant of concern by the World Health Organization.
Yeah, good morning, Jane. Thanks for coming on our program. How concerned are Australia's health authorities and the World Health Organization about this?
Well, every time we see a variant, obviously we want to know whether it's going to be worse in terms of transmissibility and the effect on people's health. This one is now classified by the World Health Organization as a variant of concern. They've done that because it looks more transmissible. It's got mutations, which are worrying people. So, yes, this is one that we're all quite worried about.
Does this mean it could be worse than Delta? What more do we know about this strain?
Well, it was only identified on the 9th of November, so it's very early, but we're already seeing a large number of the cases being diagnosed, for example, in South Africa, actually being this strain. So we know it's potentially more transmissible. We also think that it may actually cause what's called immune escape. So that means that it may be that you're more likely to catch it. So it's more transmissible and potentially it can evade some of the vaccines. Now, we don't know yet everything about this, but certainly the early indications from those 9 countries that we've already seen referred to is that there are things here that the mutations are worrying.
Yeah, that all sounds pretty scary. I know it's early days, but what are the thoughts? Will our vaccines provide us any protection from Omicron?
Well, we hope so. And, of course, you've just seen Kamala Harris, the US Vice President, encouraging people to get vaccinated and to get a booster if they're eligible, because we know when you first had your vaccine, you're at a very high level of protection. So we're certainly hoping that that's the case. But with all these variants, with all these different changes in the virus, we have to keep monitoring. And of course, we've got very high levels of coverage, particularly in those eastern states. And that's great because it means many of our people will get that level of protection. But the short answer is we don't really know yet, which is why the best thing we can do now is make sure we're all vaccinated.
Well, in terms of things we can do now, we've seen the government close the border, introduce some more quarantine for even vaccinated travellers. Do you think closing the border is the right decision, and do you think we need to do anything more?
Well, certainly in the short term, a pause on people who are not citizens coming in from those countries is probably prudent. We're not the only country to have done that. And now asking people who've returned from overseas to spend that 72 hours in isolation at home is also a good move, because what enables us to do, and remember that if you get on a plane, you have to have had a negative COVID test before you get on the plane. But this variant has already got to Hong Kong and a series of other places. So what we're trying to do here is slow it down. What do we do that for? One, it gives people more chance to get vaccinated and the time to do that. But secondly, we're going to be able to learn how we might best manage this variant. So, yes, I think what they've done is absolutely sensible.
Jane, we appreciate your time on our show this morning. It seems like a scary case of deja vu, doesn't it? Incredible.
Just in time for Christmas, too.
Yeah, let's bring a nice political editor, Chris Uhlmann, for his take on this. Chris, state premiers have promised no more lockdowns. Are they going to be able to keep their word on that?
Look, after 2 years of this, Richard, I'll believe it when I see it. And we have obviously now the concern about Omicron. There has been a closure of the borders pretty much to countries that we aren't flying to directly anyway at this stage. Of course, if you're a non-citizen, then you can't come in. Really, we are repatriating citizens. I understand around about 100 have been back through New South Wales, Victoria and the ACT who haven't had to quarantine. So obviously taking some precautions on this is important. But I would say this, Richard, we have a different strain of the flu every single year. Mm. At some stage, the world's going to have to come to terms with the fact that this disease and its variants are with us forever. But will state premiers close their borders on the strength of this? Who on earth could say?
What do you expect, or anything more, do you think the federal government might be doing when it's looking as though this new variant could even threaten Christmas plans again?
Well, look, I don't think the government could do much beyond what it's doing now, which is to protect the external borders from this. But, of course, it won't come from Africa directly if it comes here, and it will inevitably come here. Like all the variants of this disease, it will come from somewhere else, so through a third-party country, Hong Kong, Singapore, you name it. That's the way the world used to work before we shut the world down. Now, if we intend to restart the world, we're going to have to deal with some level of risk that includes this disease and its variants. This, it appears to me, is the only disease in human history that no one is actually allowed to catch in Australia. If we continue with that as our baseline policy position, then we will always find a reason to keep the borders shut. We will never reopen them again.
Yeah. Chris, we were slow to roll out the vaccine, as we all know, but we sort of got there in the end. But are we going to be better with the booster shots, do you think?
Yeah, Richard, we have lots of the vaccine at the moment. Of course, the problem we had at the beginning of this year was supply. There were lots of different reasons for that. The effective attack on AstraZeneca, which happened from around the world and inside Australia, did stop us from using the drug that we were producing here. The government made quite a few mistakes on its way through on trying to get other vaccines for Australia, but inevitably we caught up, and by the end of the year we're among the most vaccinated places on earth. And really all that the government's doing now is continuing to roll on with that program, and we'll see those people, in fact the very early people who had access to vaccines, will start being vaccinated from about now, but most people from January.
Chris, we know there's an election due within the next 6 months, so we can't have you on the show and not ask you about that. Do you think there's likely to be any impact on the election with this ever-changing variant issue?
Yes, Jane, and there already is, because, of course, we see that the border to Western Australia is still closed, will be closed in February, and the problem the Prime Minister has at the moment... Jane, you've been here. Have you ever seen a messier week in Parliament than the one that we just saw? If you were the Prime Minister and you're thinking about an election next year, would you want to bring this rabble back when we'll be even closer to an election? They'll be even more paranoid about what's going on in their individual seats or in their states, because that's what's driving at the moment. It's fear that they won't be there next time around. So closer to an election, they'll be even more unruly, and yet the Prime Minister might not be able to campaign in Western Australia, which is the one place he knows he has to get, because that's where they're doing very badly indeed. He has to get on the ground and test whether or not that's he can lift the fortunes of the coalition there, and he can't do that at the moment, not early next year, and who knows what Mark McGowan might do. So the Prime Minister might be forced into a position where he's got to punt the election later into the year, which would be the 21st of May, that he might like. So it's already having an effect on the election, and will, I'm pretty sure, continue to do so.
Hey, Chris, just finally, what's your take on the Gladys for Canberra campaign?
Well, look, you know, they need to win that seat in Warringah back. Zali Steggall is fairly well dug in there at the moment. I understand that there are people who would love Gladys Berejiklian to be in that seat. The Prime Minister launched a scathing attack against the Independent Commission Against Corruption, which you would think might be clearing the way for her to stand there. But at this stage, there's no indication that that's what she's willing to do. If she did stand, she would no doubt be the best possible candidate for that seat, and that would worry Zali Steggall a lot, I would imagine.
Watch this space.
There you go. Thanks, Chris. Appreciate
Thank you, Chris.
It.
Thank you.